Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm Peter Goddard, Director of the Institute. It's my pleasure to welcome you here to this discussion of secularism and human rights, basic human rights in history, philosophy, political science, and sociology, which is part of our celebration of the Institute's 80th anniversary. Our moderator today is Harold Shapiro, President Emeritus of and Professor of Economics and Public Affairs at Princeton University, and we're delighted to say, since 2009, a trustee of the Institute. Harold.
Peter, thank you very much. Let me extend my own warm welcome to this morning's discussion that, as Peter has said just a moment ago, centers around secularism and human rights. It is an honor and pleasure to serve as moderator of this morning's discussion, led by the distinguished panel of scholars sitting here on my right. Let me begin, however, by briefly outlining the kind of general structure that we have planned for this morning's discussions. The first hour or so will really be given over to statements and observations by our panelists here. We will then break for tea and coffee over at Fold Hall after that for about 20 minutes or 25 minutes or so. I think you can't have an event here at the Institute without breaking for coffee at Fold Hall, so just to make sure we know where we are, we're going to be there for half an hour roughly, and then we'll reassemble back here for some discussion amongst the panelists themselves, and most importantly, for some conversation, Q&A and so on between the panelists and the audience here today. So we're certainly looking forward to that very, very much. Our distinguished panel this morning consists of four faculty of the Institute, each of which, in their own and very different fashion, has been and continues to be a transformative agent in their own area of scholarship. Taken together, at least in my view, the corpus of their work illustrates just why the Institute continues to be one of the important hubs of scholarship in the humanities and social sciences. Moreover, it at least is interesting and telling to me that the influence of each of these morning's panelists extends well beyond their particular field. Indeed, although I am an economist, I have read with great interest and profit a great deal of the work of each of them, and it certainly enriched my own experience and scholarly background as well. Now, to avoid too much up and down here on the stage, I will briefly introduce each of the panelists now, and then ask each to address you. And I think I will introduce them in the order in which they are going to speak. Essentially, it works out from my left to right, the way we happen to sit ourselves here, although that wasn't planned. The first to speak this morning will be Joan Wallach Scott, the Harold F. Linder Professor in the School of Social Sciences. Joan's groundbreaking work has challenged the foundation of conventional historical practice, including the nature of historical evidence and historical experience and the role of narrative in the writing of history. Broadly, the objective of her work is the question of difference in history, its uses, enunciations, implementations, justifications, and transformation in the construction of social and political life. Sitting next to her is Didier Fassin, who is a James D. Wolfensohn Professor in the School of Social Science. He is an anthropologist and a sociologist who has conducted field studies in Senegal, Ecuador, South Africa, and France. Trained as a physician in internal medicine and public health, he dedicated his early research to medical anthropology, illuminating important issues around the AIDS epidemic, social inequalities in health, and the changing landscape of global health. More recently, he has developed a new domain of inquiry he terms, and I put in quotation marks, political and moral anthropology, analyzing the reformulation of injustice and violence as suffering and trauma, the expansion of an international humanitarian government, and the contradictions in the contemporary politics of life. His present project, A Contribution to the Anthropology of the State, explores the political and moral treatment of disadvantaged groups, including immigrants and refugees, through an ethnography of police, justice, and prison. Avishai Margalit, sitting also to my right, just one over, is George F. Kennan Professor in the School of Historical Studies. Is one of the foremost thinkers and commentators on the contemporary human condition, the moral issues of our time, and the current problems facing Western societies. In addition to his influence as a philosopher, he is highly regarded for his profound and cogent observations of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and the broader struggle between Islam and the West. On my far right is Jonathan Israel. Many of you heard him yesterday speaking to the wonderful lecture he gave us yesterday afternoon. He is professor in the School of Historical Studies. His work is concerned with European and European colonial history from the Renaissance to the 18th century. His recent work focuses on the impact of radical thought, especially Spinoza, Bale, Diderot, and the idea of democracy, equality, toleration, freedom of press, and individual freedom. Many books concerned with focused on these subjects. So let me now turn to our very distinguished panel and call on Joan first.
Professor Thank Scott. You. We decided that it would be more panel-like if we sat rather than came up to the podium. My comments take off from a new book by historian Samuel Moyne, who was a member in the School of Historical Studies in 2008-09. It's called The Last Utopia, Human Rights in History. And it takes issue with the idea that there's a continuous evolution in the idea of human rights from the Enlightenment or the French Revolution, the American and French Revolutions, to the present. Moyne argues instead that the concept of individual human rights, and individual is the crucial term, as we know it today, an internationalist cause that was, quote, a pure alternative in an age of ideological betrayal and political collapse, end of quote, came into its own only in 1977, and he's very precise about that year. In that year, Charter 77 was founded in Czechoslovakia. President Jimmy Carter invoked human rights in his inaugural address, and Amnesty International, the grassroots group devoted to, quote, saving the world one individual at a time, won the Nobel Peace Prize. A year later, Helsinki Watch, which in 1988 became Human Rights Watch, came into being, and Vaclav Havel wrote that human rights were the power of the powerless, by which he meant that human rights were not about the rights of citizens within the nation state, as they had been for at least two centuries. They were instead a way of challenging, in Moyne's words, the sovereign nation state from above and outside, rather than serve as its foundation. Rights were no longer taken to be the prerogative of citizens who were members of a specific political community, he argues, but instead belonged to all as a function of their humanity. For Moyne, this represents a profound change, a substitution of morality for older forms of politicized struggle, a sign of the failure of the utopian politics of redemption, whether socialist, communist, anti-communist, or anti-colonial. Moyne's goal in the book is to offer an alternative history, one that stresses not the origins of ideas, but their contingent emergence. One that thinks in terms not of linear continuities, but of sharp breaks. One that insists on exploring the different meanings that the same words can have at different historical moments. It's an important exercise, and if you want to see how he makes his case, which I think is more or less convincing depending on the part of the book you read, you can read the book. But for now, And I have to say, although his approach to history is one that I take myself, it's not what I want to talk about or do today. I want to come at the question of rights in history from a different angle, one that focuses on an ongoing tension within the conception of rights itself, whether the rights of the citizen of the American and French Revolutions or the more recent human rights for the victims of totalitarian rule. That is a tension between rights conceived as formal limits on the power of states, whether the limit comes from inside or outside, and rights conceived as positive social or economic entitlements. The first is associated with the formal rights of individuals before the law, the second with the social rights of groups as well as individuals. The first rests on an abstract concept of the individual, shorn from his social, cultural, and economic locations, and for that reason, equal. All citizens are equal to one another in this view precisely because of abstraction. So there's that side. The first rests on an abstract concept of the individual, shorn from his economic, cultural, and economic locations. The second insists that social locations do matter and that real equality is not formal but substantive. In the early 18th century versions of rights talk, the rights of man meant literally the rights of men, and not all men, but only those with a stake, usually ownership of property, in the nation. Equality before the law claimed not to take social, economic, or other factors into account. The individual was, as I just said, an abstraction, not a real being, and as such, the equal of any other individual in the eyes of the law. The terms of citizenship, however, excluded those who did not meet the definition of individual, because for the very social or economic factors that weren't supposed to matter, they lacked autonomy, independence, and or reason. So in the first constitution of the French Revolution in 1791, women were not considered active citizens, nor were slaves in the colonies, nor were those men in France who depended on wages. The critique these groups offered of their exclusion claimed equality, but not in the abstract terms the revolutionaries had articulated. Their call was for group rights, understood substantively in terms of their social position or economic need. They argued that without consideration of these needs, there could be no formal equality, that equality before the law depended on social equality. So here is Olympe de Gouges, whom you heard about yesterday, author of the Declaration of the Rights of Women and Citizens in 1791. As Jonathan showed you in those two wonderful slides, her declaration parallels almost exactly the one proclaimed in 1789, but adds certain substantive demands. For example, Article 11 reads this way: "The free communication of thoughts and opinions is one of the most precious rights of women, since that liberty assures the recognition of children by their fathers. Any female citizen thus may say freely, 'I am the mother of a child which belongs to you,' without being forced by barbarous prejudice to hide the truth." This was the rights of free speech applied specifically to the case of women. Or in 1796, Francoise Noël, known as Gracchus Babeuf, produced his Manifesto of Equals. In it, he denounced what he called the fiction of equality before the law, calling instead for common property or a community of goods. Quote, "We declare that we can no longer suffer that the great majority of men shall labor and sweat to serve and pamper the extreme minority. Away forever with the revolting distinctions of rich and poor, of great and little, of masters and servants, of governed and governed. Let there no longer be any other differences in mankind than those of age and sex," end of quote. In France in 1848, the protesters who brought down the monarchy and ushered in the Second Republic added the right to work to their list of demands. Universal manhood suffrage was not enough. In their estimation, citizens deserved social guarantees from the democratic governments they brought into being. The right to work did not become a constitutional guarantee of the Second Republic, but the tension between the liberal and social visions of citizenship continued. That tension is evident in the history Moyne recounts leading up to and coming out of 1977. The United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948 did not resolve the tension. It stays on the side of formal rights. Human rights, Moyne says, were most often synonymous with social democracy in Western nations in the 1940s, swinging the pendulum towards social rights. In the Cold War era, they became a weapon against communist regimes, especially as a defense of Christian religious freedom against Soviet oppression. Then it was liberty of individual conscience that was at issue. The American civil rights movement took up the call for human rights and increasingly demanded socioeconomic equality for African Americans. In response, American liberals, leery, Moyne says, of conservative backlash, insisted on the individual nature of human rights. One man, one vote was okay, but serious attention to racial inequality was not. Anti-colonial movements were treated suspiciously by Western liberals when they listed self-determination as a human right. Indeed, Moyne notes that it is only with the waning of anti-colonialism that human rights were reclaimed in campaigns for individual rights. But that didn't last either. In the late 1980s and early 90s, women's movements introduced the slogan, "Women's Human Rights," to insist that there were gender-specific issues that had to be addressed, in a way echoing Olympe de Gouges. The abstraction of the individual citizen had too long veiled an implicit masculinity, they argued. It was time now to recognize that without reproductive freedom and protections against rape, sexual terrorism, and domestic violence, women could never enjoy equal rights with men. Here is how these movements defined it, and this is a long quote. "By calling upon the indivisibility of women's human rights, women have rejected a human rights hierarchy which places either political or civil rights or socioeconomic rights as primary. They want it all. Instead, women have charged that political stability cannot be realized unless women's social and economic rights are also addressed. That sustainable development is impossible without simultaneously respect for and incorporation into the policy process of women's cultural and social roles in the daily reproduction of life, and that social equity cannot be generated without economic justice and women's participation at all levels of political decision making, end of quote. Despite Moyne's attempt to carefully cordon off a meaning for human rights as about individuals, the tensions within the term continue to evade that historian's control. Moyne argues that humanitarianism, a concern for victims of war, terror, and natural disasters, is not the same as movements to protect individual rights. And although it's hard sometimes to tell, he clearly prefers the movements for individual rights. And I'm sure he's technically right about that. But there's one example of a national constitution that expands the definition of citizenship and human rights, a recent national constitution, beyond the abstract notions of individuals, and yet is not about victims and humanitarianism either. And that's the post-apartheid South African constitution. The Bill of Rights in that document is a long one and includes many articles that would have been familiar to the authors of 18th century American or French liberal declarations. But there are rights enumerated as well that are social and substantive. The right to fair labor practices, the right that everyone has to, quote, an environment that is not harmful to their health or well-being, and to have the environment protected for the benefit of present and future generations through reasonable legislative and other measures that, one, prevent pollution and ecological degradation, two, promote conservation, and three, secure ecologically sustainable development and use of natural resources while promoting justifiable economic and social development. The question, of course, is how this has or it will play out politically. It's one, a question that we don't have time for today and that we wouldn't be able to answer yet anyway. It's not for historians of the future, it's for historians of the future to tell us what the effects were or will be of this constitution that tried to resolve what I think is a constitutive tension of human rights talk, which I guess I think is not resolvable. They tried to combine liberal and substantive theories of rights, rights that were not only about the abstractions of citizenship, but what about it concretely means to be human. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fassin.
Thank you. My main argument, simply exposed, and as you will see, it echoes what was just said, is the following. In the recent decades, in the politics of human rights, the early history of which was remarkably presented yesterday by Jonathan Israel, the right to life has become overwhelmingly prominent, whereas economic and social rights have been relegated to a secondary position. I consider this evolution to be a major transformation in the moral economy of contemporary societies. I would like to briefly discuss some elements about the genealogy, contradictions, and implication of this irresistible rise of the right to life, to use a Brecht-like formulation. I will do it starting with a story collected during my fieldwork in South Africa. On the 7th of April 2001, the auditorium of the Humanities Building at the prestigious Wits University in Johannesburg was the scene of a social drama that rarely occurs in the academia. This was on the final day of the AIDS in Context conference, which had brought together social scientists from Southern Africa to discuss the historical, political, cultural, and social dimensions of the epidemic. 1 year prior, the country had suddenly become aware of the gravity of the sanitary situation with the publication of alarming morbidity and mortality data. 1/5 of the adult population, that is 5 million individuals, were infected, and AIDS had become the first cause of death, threatening to reduce by 20 years the life expectancy of South Africans within 2 decades. But the country had also become conscious of the tensions raised by the dissident interpretation of the disease and its treatment, with the president and his health minister challenging the viral origin of the disease and the efficacy of antiretroviral drugs. On the last day of the conference, a round table was dedicated to AIDS policies and the politics of AIDS. A new regimen had been recently tested in Uganda for the prevention of mother-to-child transmission of HIV, consisting of a single dose of nevirapine to the mother during labor and to the child immediately after birth, which decreased by half infections among children. However, The South African government was reluctant to generalize the implementation of this supposedly wonder drug, arguing that its side effects, in particular viral resistance, had not been sufficiently investigated. The first speaker, Zaki Ahmad, the charismatic chair of the Treatment Action Campaign, a non-governmental organization engaged in access to antiretroviral drugs, launched a virulent attack against the government and accused those in charge of the management of the epidemic of being responsible for, I quote, Holocaust against the poor. Citing the case of a recently deceased woman who had left three infected child behind, he denounced these officials as, quote, accomplices of the death of all these children. His speech was warmly applauded. Taking the floor immediately after him, Nono Simelela, the respected director of the National AIDS Program, affirmed, her voice broken by sobs, that being a gynecologist and a mother, she felt profoundly hurt by this incrimination. Having recalled the legacy of apartheid with the racial separation of an ineffective and unequal health system, she evoked her responsibility to avoid deepening existing health and social disparity. And she concluded that it was, quote, a question of equity and ethics. At the end of her talk, visibly distressed, she swiftly left the auditorium. This dispute could have been seen as one more episode in the harsh battle between AIDS activists defended by medical doctors and AIDS officials supported by public health specialists in South Africa. However, this unusual scenario in an academic environment gave the audience the feeling that we had experienced a historical moment. Rather, it was a sort of epiphany. The revelation that the confrontation was not between the ethics of the activists and the unethical position of the officials, as it was usually represented, but that two ethics were at stake. One was defending a right to life, the other a right to justice. Of course, Zaki Ahmad was no more opposed to the principle of justice than Nono Simelela was refuting the value of human life. But the impassioned debates around the prevention of mother-to-child transmission crystallized two moral communities around two ethical stances. What is remarkable is that the only position that was heard, and one may say audible, was the defense of life. The fact that it concerned children added to the compassionate turn of the activist campaign and of the media mobilization, with pictures of newborns recurrently on the front page of newspapers under the headline, "Save Our Babies." By contrast, social justice was never invoked. Actually, the case was taken to court significantly through the accusation of the government by an infected baby and his mother, pleading the right to life, which is inscribed in the South African 1996 constitution. The plaintiffs won, and the Ministry of Health was forced to implement the regimen. To my knowledge, no one ever took action against the state in the name of the right to justice, which is also inscribed in the Constitution, in spite of the fact that social inequalities have continued to increase since the end of apartheid. A troubling fact of the story, however, and this will be of interest for John Scott, is that the whole conception of the prevention of mother-to-child transmission and its justification, at least initially, by the Treatment Action Campaign, were based on the idea of saving babies and never of treating women, with the untold consequence that not only antiretroviral therapies for women were not included in the initial regimens, but that single-dose nevirapine had for implication that later treatment of mothers became extremely problematic because of induced viral resistance. Saving babies went not only with neglecting women, but sometimes with condemning them to treatment failure. In other words, right to life was not claimed with equal energy for all. This South African story may serve as a parable for a more general trend in contemporary societies. In the often quoted last chapter of The Will to Know, Michel Foucault asserts that modernity is characterized by the shift from sovereign power, that is the power to kill, to biopower, that is the power to make live, by which he means the power to measure, regulate and normalize life. Quote, modern man, he writes, is an animal whose politics places his existence as a living being into question, end quote. My theoretical proposition is that contemporary societies are certainly governed by the logics of biopower, the power over life, but perhaps even more decisively by the logics of biolegitimacy, the legitimacy of life as a supreme good. In his critique of violence, Walter Benjamin advocatiously acknowledged this evolution, interpreting, I quote, the sanctity of life, that is for him the mere fact of being alive, as, quote again, a recent dogma for which he called for more inquiry. It is likely that the killing fields of the two world wars, the memory of the totalitarian regimes, the trace of 20th century massacres and genocides have contributed to this advent of life as the ultimate human right. It is also probable that the genealogy of this transformation involves more profound anthropological changes in the relation to the sacred, the moral investment in the value of life, replacing a certain loss of religious transcendence. But whatever our understanding of the phenomenon is, one cannot deny the force of the right to life in contemporary societies. It has become so self-evident that not only killing others, even under the harshest conditions of oppression, but is considered absolutely unjustified, but also killing oneself, even as a sacrifice to a superior cause, is seen as an incomprehensible moral scandal. By referring to the killings of others and of oneself, I obviously imply that this principle of biolegitimacy is not shared by all societies, some considering individual or collective rights to dignity or freedom or sovereignty as superior. It is indeed one of the major ethical conflicts in our world. The right to life as a supreme good is both historically constituted and culturally circumscribed. It has not always existed, and it does not exist everywhere. But do not misinterpret me. I'm not defending moral relativism. I even consider that biolegitimacy has a specific historical legitimacy in countries like South Africa or Colombia, which have inscribed the right to life in their new constitutions after decades when the value of life of the majority was so profoundly denied because of racial apartheid and civil war, respectively. So my point is not to contest, obviously, the right to life, but to scrutinize its contradictions and implications. Contradictions are of two kinds, internal and external. Internal contradiction, the right to life does not consider all kinds of life equally, and for instance, individuals or states who consider abortion to be the intolerable murder of a living being frequently do not see any problem in the death penalty for people who are convicted of crimes. An external contradiction, the right to life is not implemented equally for all, and for example, when NATO bombings occurred over Kosovo to protect the Albanian-speaking population, the decision to have planes fly at a high altitude to avoid the Serb anti-aircraft defense had for consequence the inadvertent killing of about 500 Kosovar civilians. The zero death doctrine, on the one side, had for corollary the collateral damage theory for the other one. But the valorization of the right to life is not just confronted to its contradiction, it also has implications. First, it often obliterates competing rights, particularly the social and economic rights. Thus, moral and political mobilization in favor of a child threatened by a severe disease or of a hostage kidnapped by a guerrilla is much more consensual and effective than around health disparities, which are translated into a difference of 9 years of life expectancy between unqualified workers and university professors in France or in the United States, into the fact that the loss of life from income inequality is comparable to the combined loss of life from lung cancer, diabetes, motor vehicle crashes, HIV infection, suicide, and homicide. Neither in France nor in the United States are these facts a source of moral indignation. Second, the exclusiveness of the right to life disqualifies the claims of others when they defend other values as their priority. Activists in the streets of Tehran or in the square of Tiananmen, oppressed people in Kurdistan or Palestine may consider freedom or sovereignty a higher value than their lives, as did French resistance fighters during World War II or the American colonists combating for their independence at the end of the 18th century. So to conclude and to return to my inaugural South African scene, there is no theoretical reason to oppose the right to life of the child, but also of the mother, and the right to justice and not mere subsistence. It just happens that in South Africa, as in many other contexts, not only are they frequently defended as mutually exclusive, but also the right to life has become a way of dismissing, or at least forgetting, social and economic rights. And this is what social science is about, accounting for things not as they should be, but as they are. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Margalit.
At a certain point in his masterful lecture, Jonathan muttered, "I can give you 2,000 examples of that." I don't remember what was the "that" about, but knowing how erudite Jonathan is, I believed him. I was raised among philosophers, and as John Austin said about them, when philosophers said that they have many examples, they mean that they have one. And when they say that they have infinite number of examples, they mean exactly two. And yet, in crucial moment, Jonathan, with all his generous and expensive mood yesterday, was give us very strict diet of examples of human rights. Namely, all his radical saints who were marshaled in talked about equality, about all the noble ideals, but concrete rights weren't really there apart from freedom of expression. And I think that there is a problem here, and let me say what is the problem. The problem is that the talk about human rights vacillate between two notions of human rights. One is human rights as synonymous with global justice or with natural, reasoned justice, a just order. I call it the fat notion of human rights. The lean notion of human rights is minimal, is a threshold requirement to be a legitimate society or a legitimate state. And the main practice of human rights in recent year leans towards the lean notion of human rights rather than what I suspect was the noble goal of the radical philosopher who actually talked about a moral order based on reason. So when we try to assess a fruit tree, we usually inspect the fruits rather than expose the roots. And the point is whether human rights are fruit-like, fruit trees, whether we should inspect the actual practice of human rights as it is currently perceived and talked about, or whether we should expose the roots. And I think that Jonathan convinced me yesterday that there is a great merit in exposing the historical roots. The great merit is that part of exposing the root provide us with the main traditional reason for human rights, namely human nature. as an argument for human rights. In Dostoevsky's famous novel, The Devils, or the Demons of the Possessed, there is this dark prince, Stavrogin, who says that every human being is worthy of an umbrella. And it's a human right to have an umbrella. I maintain that every human being should have an access to clean water, to reasonably clean water, and to reasonable quantity of clean water. Now, how do I know that Stavrogin is wrong, an umbrella is not a basic human right, whereas clean water, although it's not listed on any list, should be a human right? So one way to go to the tradition is to say it's a basic human need to have clean water, whereas umbrella is not. But then, once we look at the actual list of human rights in the Declaration of Human Rights of 1948 and all the covenants that accompanied it, there are vast numbers of human rights, such as due process human rights, not to be arrested secretly or not having a secret trial, or social rights which weren't actually in the Declaration of Human Rights. There was a compromise between the Russians and the Americans. The Russians pushed for social rights in order to embarrass the Americans. The Americans pushed to individual rights in order to embarrass the Russians, and they agreed to sign both on two different documents. But in any case, all of them I include as a human rights, and I can't in the life of me see how they can be justified by an appeal to human nature. I think that the idea is powerful, but most of those human rights evolved, to my mind, after the Second World War, mostly as a reaction to the evils of Nazism. And they addressed various evils without having a coherent view of them. And the success of agreeing on human rights was exactly on giving on the aspiration to find a foundation, a philosophical foundation that underpinning the human rights. Jacques Maritain, a great Catholic philosopher, who was a prime mover in the human rights of 1948, said that the success was that we agreed on the content of the rights without agreeing on anything to do with the justification. We couldn't. And I think that that's the right approach. Human rights is a kit of tools. It's not a theory. They don't have to cohere. You use them against things that people intuitively identify as evil. And I think that the idea of trying to find foundations is a wrong tack. Look at the practice, not at the foundation. Now, one more thing. Religious morality is usually duty-centered morality. Thou shalt not. Secular movements usually start with rights. It's a right-centered moralities. And there is a great deal of sense in it. Rights is what we want to ourselves. Duty is what we want others to have. But this right-centered approach hides a very troubling problem. Honora Anil, a philosopher, called it the dark side of human rights. Dark, not in the sense of sinister, the way Stavrogin was, but dark in the sense of dark matter or the dark side of the moon, an unobserved element. And why do I say that something troubling was hiding beyond the talk of human rights? No one spelled out seriously who burdened the obligation to protect the rights. Now, there is one direct agency, namely the state. And Jonathan mentioned, rightly, that there was stress on sovereignty. So states are the agents to look after the human rights of the people under their jurisdiction. But the main problem of human rights today is that we are facing failed states in the sense of states that are inapable and incapable, both in terms of resources and power, to look after the human rights of the people under their jurisdiction, or rotten states, when the states are the main instigator of violating the human rights of the people. And the problem of human rights today is to intervene in the sovereignty of those states. To what an extent we are entitled to intervene, because sovereignty is a major group right, and human rights came together to the world. And yet there is a tremendous tension between these two basic values, defending human rights, individual and group, and defending self-determination and sovereignty. That's the problem, that's the main problem, I think, of our time. And how to avoid using human rights and interference with sovereignty as a disguised form of neocolonialism. That's the real problem. And that's why NGOs are so important. You have to come to deal with human rights, especially in cases of interference, with clean hands. And those who have the power to intervene have no clean hands, and those who have clean hands have no power to intervene. That's the story, and that is why it's so difficult. So it's not an harmonious story of all the good things go together, but there are inner tensions, and the main one is between human rights and sovereignty.
Professor Israel.
Thank you. Well, I'd like to, having perhaps said enough already yesterday afternoon, confine myself during my 10 minutes or so to just commenting briefly on some of the very important issues that have been brought up by the other three. So, and perhaps I will move in reverse order and start with Avishai's comments. Of course, I agree very much that sovereignty and self-determination are in tension with human rights in certain contexts, and that there are no harmonious stories behind any of the major trends in modern history. Why would one expect that? Surely one wouldn't. There's nothing new about this tension. It was a very real tension, I think, from the beginning of the revolution, that France proclaimed these human rights. Immediately said that these human rights are not being respected in neighboring states. There were tensions straight away with states on all sides. And the temptation to intervene could be interpreted in different ways. It could be, and was, interpreted by many in the Dutch Republic, for instance, or in the Genevan Republic, as coming to the aid of democrats who had been oppressed and cheated by aristocrats and were now being saved by revolutionary France. Or you could interpret it as a sovereign interference in the rights of another state, which was simply an attempt to extend the power of France. There's no easy solution to this, of course not. But what seems to me and this is perhaps also something I'd want to extend in my comments to what the other two speakers have said as well. So remarkable about the way the concept of human rights developed before the revolution in 1789 and was then encapsulated in the decrees, the Declaration of the Rights of Man and other decrees of the revolution before the Robespierrist period, is precisely that individual rights are, I think, listed to a much greater extent than you were willing to concede, certainly not just freedom of expression. There were many other fruits in this, and the clear declaration of equality before the law, which is something sensationally new in an 18th century context, and the unity and equality of all races and peoples, which of course was emphatically denied by many or most philosophers in the 18th century, is a very remarkable development. And the immediate willingness of Condorcet and his allies, not only to extend the principles that they were proclaiming to the black populations of the Caribbean and to attack the problem of slavery with renewed impetus, but even the leaders at least, to consider that this was something that had to be applied to the case of women as well, seems to me a great turning point in the history of the world. But the crucial thing is that it was, and this is why I tried in my lecture yesterday to put so much emphasis on the role of a certain wing of the Enlightenment, of a certain section among the philosophers, that for them this was a system. So it's not just that we're speaking about origins. Of course, I think the role of the Enlightenment is absolutely indispensable to any discussion of the history of human rights if we're looking at origins and background. But what seems to me so interesting in the context of the latter stages of the history of human rights since 1948 is precisely this bringing together of individual rights with the nation, with problems of sovereignty, with problems of violence and peace, and refusing to separate the possibility of individual rights from the political proposition that the duty of society, the duty of the philosophes, the duty of educated opinion is to prevent the state from preying on the common welfare, on the interests of the majority, by representing or being captured by vested interests. And if Avishai put his finger on one of the issues which is very central indeed to the problems and tensions of the world today, the problem of how you prevent governments being captured by vested interests and pursuing policies which are, by every objective measure, negative, damaging to the interests of the majority of the population seems to me equally central. An equally difficult problem. So I would want to focus my remarks mainly on a rejection of the point that Joan attributed quite rightly to this recent book by Sam Moyne, the Last Utopia. Indeed, he likes sharp breaks, and indeed he does separate the history of human rights in the recent era with remarkable emphasis from all that went before and from the Enlightenment. It's not very clear to me that he has any good arguments for this. And not only does the thesis itself seem to be wrong, but it seems to be the source of his inability to see why there wasn't actually a fundamental separation between individual rights and the claim that democratic societies and the reshaping of the state itself is the only way that these rights can be pursued and safeguarded. The two things go together, the proclaiming of the rights and the proclaiming the need for democratic societies if there's to be any chance of those rights being upheld and maintained is completely inseparable. And therefore, I can only say how much I agree with what seemed to be the central theme of Didier Fassin's remarks, that contexts change, fashions change, situations are different. South Africa is the most remarkable drama in recent years, since the beginnings of black rule. But if you're going to look at the list of rights as a list of rights and leave out the foundation, leave out the philosophical background that lies behind it, and that philosophical background, for precisely this reason, seems to me not only crucial to history, and I'd like to repeat, I don't think you can understand anything about the beginning of the rise of human rights without that philosophical background, but also as something which is still today profoundly topical, because the temptation or the or a convergence of social pressures that lead to one or two social rights being emphasized in such a way as to unbalance the whole picture and have a negative effect and prejudice other areas of human rights. Of course, this is both inevitable and very much facilitated by simply looking at human rights as a list of things that men may or may not be entitled to. Detaching this entirely from a political apparatus which was supposed to be inseparable from it in the early stages and from those social rights that some wanted to include and others didn't in 1948 and from a philosophical framework which I would claim was sporadically, not only sporadically dominant in the late 18th century, but was the only factor that made possible the proclaiming of the rights of man and citizen in the form that it took, and a conception of philosophy which has largely been rejected by the 19th and 20th centuries, but which still has a certain relevance to us today, precisely because it was the frame which made possible this linkage between basic human rights and democracy as the only legitimate representative democracy. There's a great emphasis amongst the people I was referring to, representative democracy as against direct democracy, representative democracy as the only political and social frame which can pursue and uphold those human rights. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. You've given us all a lot to think about, and we'll return to that conversation roughly 20 or 25 minutes from now, so I'd like to invite you all to join us in Fold Hall for some coffee or tea, and then reassemble back here in approximately 25 minutes. Thank you very much. Well, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we want to get this part of our session started. I want to thank the panelists for a very intriguing set of comments. Not only that, but I didn't have to remind any one of the panelists about the time at all during this whole procedure, but we had a lot to think about between abstract individual rights and substantive rights, fat rights and thin rights, life versus justice, and so on. And who is going to protect these rights anyways? Well, it's the state's going to protect them. On the other hand, the states are the problem. So we have a lot of tensions in here, and I've only mentioned some of them. So the format we're going to follow is to see if any of the panelists have any comments or questions of their colleagues here or statements they'd like to make in relation to what their colleagues had to say, and then we'll turn to the audience for a Q&A period. So let me turn to the panelists first, see if there's a panelist who would like to start this discussion. Silence. I guess they like what each other said, or have already said, as Professor Israel already commented on his own views of some of the things that have been said. Well, in that case, yes, DJ?
Yeah. Maybe I can react to what Avishai has said in the final part of his presentation, which I enjoyed very much. He brought the question of sovereignty, and in particular, I would like to just bring two points. One is you gave you the definition of two kinds of state which were problematic to you. One was the failed state, who are incapable of enforcing human rights. The other one is rotten states, which are even responsible of the violation of human rights, and I agree with that. Maybe in the picture I would add a third group of democratic potent or powerful states, which we're familiar with, and their restriction or their contradiction in their way of dealing with human rights of these other states, and I'm referring in particular to the restriction of asylum rights in Western countries, in Western Europe and France in particular. Just think that in France, the rate of agreement to asylum for people who are soliciting a status of refugee has gone down from 95% in 1976, so from 95% to 6% right now. So you had about 19 out of 20 people who were agreed the status of refugee, and some 30 years later, we're 1 out of 19 that is agreed. So this, I think, also has to be put into the picture, that these difficulties sometimes a contradiction, and the fact that in Western Europe, for example, or in the European Union, asylum rights have been more and more integrated in as a problem of immigration control rather than asylum. And the second point is what you very interestingly mentioned about the opposition between human rights and right to sovereignty, and we know how complicated this issue is, and we're talking about intervening in countries where human rights are not implemented. I would say that if we, two things about it. One is that if we look at the recent history, that is the last two decades, it has never been human rights, if I'm correct, it has never been human rights, but humanitarian law, which has been the justification of the intervention in different countries. And this is a point in favor of the differentiation, which exists de facto, or de jure, between human rights and humanitarian law. You intervene to protect a population because this population is supposedly at risk of being exterminated. You don't intervene militarily in a country because the freedom of press or any other of these classical human rights are at stake. A caveat to that is, in fact, very often, and this might be the influence of the French rhetoric, the focus has been put on the right to intervene, or even sometimes the duty to intervene. In fact, what the United Nations have declared as a new obligation is the responsibility to protect, which is very different from the right to intervene. The responsibility to protect means that you should use all the means, the possible means, to protect a population, which include negotiation, embargo, and not only the military solution. So I'm not saying that it has been really correctly implemented. I'm just saying that the question is less today about the right to intervene rather than the question of the responsibility to protect.
Yes, Avishai.
I want to say something about the religious roots of human rights. And I'll start with a very simple example. We founded a human rights organization in Israel to deal with the West Bank and Gaza. And the people who were the group at the time were, I think, all secular, later on joined, religious people joined. But if I remember correctly, they were all secular Jews. And the name we adopted for this organization is Betzelem. Betzelem means in the image of, in reference to Genesis, that we were all created in the image of God. And this was quite natural, not forced, not even, no one there was even market conscious how to sell our commodities, which no one wants really, under a more appealing label. Because I think it was part of the cultural association of these people that that we were created in the image of God, of the God we don't believe in, but at least we were all created in that image. And this was quite taken naturally. I believe that actually I have a better view on natural law and natural law advocates in the Catholic, among Catholics, and the whole tradition of natural law and its influence on human rights. And then Jonathan obviously takes. But the issue that I would like to address is really, and it has to do with mentioning the Catholic here, is the issue of sovereignty vis-a-vis human rights. Actually, it goes very well back, even unto the, I think, the Concordat of Worms in 1122, when at the end of the investiture wars in Europe, or the investiture conflict between the Papal State and the Holy Roman Empire. The issue was that the church thought that it's not a territorial entity and it can intervene in other states and principalities. And I think that this remained more or less the position for a long time. Sovereignty was taken as a form of idolatry. And by idolatry, I mean making an ultimate value of something which is not worth, either has no value or not at least ultimate value. Whereas the Protestants, Lutherans, and Calvinists, they were the ones to advocate sovereignty, territorial nation states, to weaken the church and the hold of the church. And part of the attitude to sovereignty and intervening on behalf of humans in the other places can go way back. It didn't start with the French Revolution. And I think that the tension was always there. And by tension, I mean the following. There is a human rights fantasy that we live in a cosmopolitan world, basically. And the word globalization now helps it. Basically, we live in an international world which consists of nation states predominantly. And they are there to stay for a long time. There is no politics in cosmopolitics, it's just a stoic metaphor. And we can't address as if the human rights issue will be remained to the world to solve this in this cosmopolitan frame. It's for the states mainly, and to the states to be pushed by lobbyists of NGOs who are concerned with human rights. That's, in my lifetime, that's what I think will still be valid. And I believe that the issue that the dark side of human rights, dark in the sense of the unobserved, is that people worked a great deal, thinking a great deal of the entitlements and the rights of people, and they didn't think hard enough about the obligation. Whose duty is to protect human rights? The neighboring UN, which agencies, which states? This, I think, remains so vague that human rights sometimes, I think, on many cases became manifesto rights and not real rights. a right is not a right without remedy. It's just a rhetorical device. And as long as we don't think seriously about the duties involved with human rights, we don't take rights seriously.
Thank you. Jonathan?
I would perhaps just like to comment on this question of natural law, which of course has a very complicated history from the Middle Ages through the early modern period, through Grotius and Pufendorf and Burlamaqui and so on, down to the Enlightenment. I think it's very important not to confuse natural law tradition, or rather natural law traditions, because there are several lines, different lines of development, with human rights in the sense that this was introduced in the 18th century by the more radical wing of the Enlightenment. These are two very different things. And when Grotius and Pufendorf, for instance, who were among the greatest architects of human rights, what they of course would agree that our understanding of reality should be based on reason, but their first premise is that reality is the empire of God. It was not a fully secular conception. And they used the premises on which they base this idea of the empire of God essentially to explain why princes and kings are not only, as a matter of fact, the rulers throughout Europe, but should be. It's a justification in Grotius, just as much, though he was living part of his life in a republic, the Dutch Republic still, he was as much a monarchical absolutist as the others in this respect. The point was to justify social hierarchy, monarchy, book censorship, all the things that basic human rights in the 18th century were designed to throw out of the window. So it's a complete confusion, I would suggest, to bring in traditions of natural law and natural right and link that with the discussion of human rights in the 18th century. In my opinion, this is a historical confusion. I tried to adduce evidence showing that the actual declarations of the rights of man in France in 1789, 1793, came out of one particular philosophical tradition and not out of other traditions, and I would stick to that. But I also, perhaps I didn't say, and I think I would want to say, that argue that it could only come out of one particular philosophical tradition, and there was no possibility of it coming out of any other tradition. And just to link that with the question that came up in the discussion yesterday about Quakers, of course there were religious groups and other groups or people committed to other ways of thinking who played a very important and liberalizing role within particular context. And no one is going to deny the very special role played by the Quakers in the beginnings of the abolitionist movement in Pennsylvania and in the US. But for them, this was an issue totally abstracted and isolated from all the rest. I was not really speaking about who first initiated the possibility of moving on in one particular issue, such as how are we going to abolish black slavery, but rather how the idea of human rights formed a system, not only a set as in the sense of being a list of human rights, both individual and collective, and to protect press freedom and freedom of expression, but tying it inseparably, from the political thesis that only representative democracies can uphold these rights and pursue these rights and fulfill these rights. So if you look at it as a system, I think it came out of one particular philosophical tradition with no other source playing an essential part. So this is an exclusive argument that I'm trying to make. And it may seem, and perhaps is to a large extent, mainly an argument about origins and about the foundation. But I also want to say that that foundation is not wholly lacking in a certain topical relevance to the new debate about human rights as it resumed after 1948.
Thank you. Joan?
I just have a quick question. It ties in exactly to what you're just saying now, Jonathan, which is your insistence on the abiding philosophical foundation for discussion of human rights. And it seems to me that it poses the notion that philosophy, everything else changes, contexts change, situations change, all sorts of things are different, but somehow the philosophical foundation is enduring. And I just wonder what that says historically for the notion of philosophy. Doesn't philosophy have a history? And don't even the very concepts that philosophers use, the question of equality, the question of representative democracy, the question of what it means to be an individual, don't those change too?
Yes, of course. And I ended by saying that the 19th century and the 20th century, on the whole, have completely rejected the Enlightenment conception of what philosophy is, and in particular, the conception of that group of what philosophy is. But we're suggesting that by ignoring or forgetting their message, we've also lost something, and that one can, I think, as is shown by the fact that there is a tension in recent times between continental philosophy and analytical philosophy, it's possible to bring to bear all sorts of criticisms on main traditions in philosophy in the 19th and 20th century on the grounds that they've not been sufficiently engagé, that they've not been broad enough, that they've not had anything to say about main social and political questions because they've conceived of philosophy in within too narrow a frame. Stop at that point.
Other comments from the members of the panel? In case I don't get a chance to ask a question later, I'm going to ask one now before I turn to the audience. Professor Fassin has written very interesting work recently on what I call states of emergencies, where states of emergencies can get extended indefinitely as an excuse or as a shield against and to argue against the full restoration of human rights because you're in an emergency and so on. So the state of emergency, which is a concept that is probably well justified in certain cases, gets misused and misapplied to the detriment of the expression of human rights, or can be that way. And I wanted to ask a similar question about human rights itself. That is, whether human rights is used as a tool by states, whether they are failed states, broken states, half-broken states or whatever, to actually as an excuse to intervene, which is really unjustified, but nevertheless it sort of plays well, just like states of emergency can be extended. You can accuse a failure of human rights and in certain countries and say you have some kind of duty to intervene in that respect. Is that an issue that one should think about, or one thinks that that's an issue of any importance in the contemporary world? That's one answer.
I'm not the expert on this, but it does seem to me that there have been many moments in which human rights has been justified as a reason for intervening, and it's been done. The critics of this would say that it's been done in contradictory ways, so that there's intervention in one place, but not in another. Iraq maybe being one example we would want to use, as opposed to North Korea, where there has not been an intervention and is an equally rotten state, to use Avishai's. So it seems to me in the contemporary world and historically, it exists in exactly the way that you're describing it.
The issue is really about hypocrisy. Whether this is the kind of thing that gives hypocrisy a bad name. and it's not clear. I think what I thought about coming with clean hands in the case of using human rights rhetoric is for regaining control, that's a serious matter. But all countries are involved to some degree in double standards and with organized, both, first of all, sovereignty, as someone called it in the title of his book, is an organized hypocrisy because powerful states always intervened in the affairs of small states. And there is a great deal, obviously, of hypocrisy in human rights talk. Like all lofty talks, it's an invitation for sentimentality and kitsch morality and all the rest. The point is how, I think, our worry, and that's, I think, a task for philosophers, is to make it a hard discourse rather than a soft Sunday talk. And that's hard.
Well, thank you very much. Let me now open the proceedings to the audience. People who have questions, I believe there are microphones around for anyone who has a question, and please use them so everyone can hear the question and so on. Why don't we go first right here on right near the aisle? There's a microphone coming right down.
Two quick questions. Avishai, with the tension between sovereignty and rights, the need for power to take responsibility and to implement, and one doesn't need power to be the passive recipient of rights, but one does need, and when the bearers of that power are violators. NGOs can and have been successful. And I'd like to push you a little on the nature of NGO power. And you know, that form of power, which is not sovereignty, it's somewhere in the middle. And I think our own experience with B'Tselem is that there's greater power for an internal, connected NGO speaking in we language, at least where we come from, than the sort of counterproductive effect of an external NGO trying to interfere and intervene from without. So if you could say something about that. And a quick question to you, Jonathan, on going back to Avishai's metaphor of the fruits and the roots. Well, looking at the post-World War II fruits of the human rights discourse, of course, the great difference is talk of collective rights, which has come up here and there in the discussion, but hasn't been taken up. Now, if we want to trace back the roots of collective rights as opposed to the sort of privatization project of individual human rights, I think we'll land up having to confront the question which wasn't confronted, and that is secularism versus human rights, because the roots will have to, in some sense, be romantic. Authenticity, nationalism, group rights, religion, not again, not the private right of the individual for religion, but rather the collective rights. You'll need to acknowledge collectives, and I think the sort of radical enlightenment roots will not be enough to account for the emergence of that anymore, and we'll have to muddy the waters, so to speak, with romantic trends, perhaps, that feed into the modern picture. Thank you.
Thank you. Avishai, why don't you answer first, then Jonathan?
Well, I mean, there is this distinction between soft power and hard power, and obviously NGO have soft power and actually used it quite effectively in the last 20, 30 years. And the main tool is naming and shaming those who violate in different ways, and it turned out to be more effective than people think, that somehow reputation counts. And so in that sense, I think there is a division of labor here, but what I tried to insist is that you need NGOs as organizations with clean hands. Hypocrisy in NGOs is a very, very bad thing, because then they lose the moral authority. You don't trust states on that, because they don't have clean hands. And you need really NGOs, and they should really try as hard as they can to be untainted, with no double standards, and so on and so forth. And it's problematic, because there are many tensions, and people try to manipulate those NGOs. The hard question is internal or external NGOs. In terms of resonating with the community, obviously internal NGOs are better, because siding with the other, with external NGOs, is almost siding with the enemy. we are under siege, there is a siege mentality, especially in countries that are accused of human rights violation. They right away form a siege mentality and are there to get us. And in this atmosphere, it's very hard. There is no universal recipe for that. I mean, it's on a retail basis, case by case. There is no wholesale solution whether it should be this or that. You have to see it case by case. And the main point is that human rights is a culture that evolves. It evolves all the time, and it's not yet stable, and the norms are not yet inscribed in a stable way. And it's evolving, and I think that the last 20 or 30 years are quite triumphant years. Good years, I won't say happy years are here again, because it means that there were happy years before. But I think there are better days now for human rights than 30 years ago.
Thank you. Jonathan?
Yes, well, I agree with the questioner that there is a big difference between the program of human rights as it emerged in the context I was describing yesterday and the post-1948 context in minority collective rights. I would just perhaps remind that the human rights framework that was introduced before and during the revolution was not just a matter of individual rights. There's a very important collective dimension linked by that political factor I mentioned, the insistence on representative democracy as the only tool for achieving and maintaining this rights. The principle, which itself was rooted in the principle that the collectivity have a right, which is that the government should rule in the interest of the majority and not be captured by vested interests. So there was a collective dimension. Also, from a strictly historical point of view, one has to remember that the program was of great benefit to particular minorities. So one of the leading revolutionary figures, actually, in the early stages of the revolution, Rabault de Saint-Étienne, was a Protestant minister from Nîmes. And the whole point for him, at least to begin with, he got caught up in other things, which but he didn't attend originally, was simply to achieve a much more satisfactory settlement for the Protestants in France, which came about precisely as a result of the human rights philosophy that was adopted. But if one wants to go further and reinforce the collective rights of minorities, which may be basically ethnic minorities or minorities interested in language rights, or religious minorities. Of course, it's the latter which is going to give rise to very real problems within the kind of framework and the kind of philosophy that the people I was talking about yesterday were presenting. Their emphasis on secularism was completely uncompromising. If the law and institutions of the state are not 100% secular, then the whole system isn't going to work and you can forget it. That was their view. Now, of course, if you're according minority rights to collectivities who want religious schools, who want religious law and so on, they're inevitably going to be difficult questions about where you draw the line, how are you going to accommodate religious law to within the wider framework of the laws of the society as a whole, and so on. And everyone can see that those are great problems and very difficult to resolve.
Okay, there are quite a few people who have questions, so I'd ask both the questioners to keep your questions short and my colleagues here to keep their answers concise as possible. I'll get back to you shortly. Is it right on this? You're pointing to someone.
This guy way in the back.
Even the panel can't agree on which hand we should look at.
He's had his hand up.
Okay, someone in the back has had their hand up a long time. Why don't you have it?
Thank you. I don't necessarily want to polarize or schematize anything, but I guess I will. If only because, for two reasons. One is that to say that these have been good decades, I wonder how in Pakistan or in the slums of Africa, one might describe the last decades as being good. I suppose it comes down to the question of sovereignty and the sovereignty to designate other sovereign states as rotten. But the other reason why I will polarize or try to polarize is because I was struck by a formal conceptual shared dimension to the three papers we heard. The opposition between formal and substantive rights seems to be parallel to, obviously, abstract and social rights, to the right to life versus the right to justice. And then, with a slight displacement, between human rights and sovereignty. But in the first paper, the first two papers, formal, abstract, and right to life was more or less designated as insufficient, not to say, to simplify, kind of bad, and substantive, social, and justice was designated as good. In the in Margalit's presentation, human right was more or less good. It's something we want, it's an evolving discourse that we want to affirm, and the last decades have been good. But sovereignty, at least the sovereignty of the rotten states, is actually bad, and it is kind of an obstacle to a better sovereignty when it comes to intervention. But I was struck that Professor Scott's description actually led us to recognize that the, much as Professor Fassin said, there's no theoretical reason for the opposition, but there seemed to be a profound political reason for the opposition, because the argument for life, or for that matter for human rights versus sovereignty, for formal rights versus substantive rights, has in fact been winning. It is the side that has been instituted most forcefully. Now, it's a contested space out there, but it seems that it's not a matter of theoretical opposition, but rather of a political contest where one side has been winning. And so I'm wondering whether we could have some clarification. Professor Scott came quite clearly on the side of substantive social right, the side of justice versus the side of life. Where Professor Margalit actually says, if we could have less of those sovereign states so that we could intervene more easily, perhaps that would be a good thing. So I'm wondering whether whether the disagreements which I perceive between the positions, which I don't think are just a matter of theoretical disagreement, but profound political disagreement, could be addressed in the light of the good decades that we have apparently lived through.
Thank you. Any comments that anyone would like to share in the panel regarding those comments? Well, let me suggest that we proceed in a little different way, because I'm anxious for get all, as many questions as we can out on the table here. So let's just take a series of questions here, and then I'll ask the panel to respond to them, the ones which they feel strongest about. Again, try to keep your, these are questions, not speeches, and so please try to ask questions, and we'll try to respond after that. Yes, over here.
The discussion today has been focused on human rights vis-a-vis the government. Many human rights organizations, including Human Rights Watch and the ACLU, have concluded that it's also necessary to protect human rights in the private sector, especially in the employment relationship. That it's just as wrong for a company to fire someone for their political speech as it is for the government to penalize them. And I wondered if the panel had any comments on that.
Thank you. Let's see what other questions might be out there. Yes, right down here in the front.
Including Russia,
Thank you very much. Very useful question. Again, it's hard to see hands. Yes, right in the very back.
Sorry to make you run. I just after reading Danielle Allen's book about citizenship, I wanted to just ask the panel about their thoughts on the issue of sacrifice in democracies, because Avishai brought up the issue of the fact that it's not clear whose responsibility it is to intervene if there is a responsibility, and I think this is something that was the central point of the book, was that in democracies, you know, that somebody must be bearing the burdens at any given point in their history.
Okay, thank you very much. There's also in the back, right in the middle, here, the microphone's close by. Yes.
I'd like the panel to comment on problems that arise from the blurring of responsibility or lines or perceived responsibility between NGOs and the military. So when you have the U.S. military advertising itself as a relief agency, what are those consequences?
Thank you. Question right here. All right. I'm sorry. We'll take it up in the back, then come back down to where you are here, because the microphone was already there.
Might the panel comment on the right to privacy?
Right to?
Privacy.
Privacy. Okay. And down here, yes. And then we'll go to see.
I have a question about the meaning of secularism, because I can imagine two meanings of that. A minimalist meaning, which says that no church or religious organization can have so much power in the state that people who are secularists can no longer enjoy the rights to freedom of expression, etc., etc. But there's also a more substantial notion of secularism, which is exemplified by the French state at present, which says that secularism has actually been a philosophy that founds the entire edifice of human rights, and that would amount to, let's say, a position where religious people have less rights of expression and freedoms than they actually could enjoy. So, and the minimalist position of secularism was also the one taken by the committee under Eleanor Roosevelt that drafted the Universal Declaration in 1948, because they insisted that they would not have an explicit philosophical foundation of the whole thing, which they couldn't anyway, because there was a neo-Confucianist philosopher in the committee and a neo-Thomist one and a French adherent of the Universal Declaration in terms of Enlightenment philosophy and an Indian activist against purdah and other limitations on women's rights. So they couldn't possibly agree on a philosophical foundation, but they could agree on the desirability of having a Universal Declaration in the first place. So I would have the opinion of the four members of the panel on minimalist versus, let's say, more substantial definition of what a secularist foundation would actually mean.
Okay, I think we've accumulated a big enough portfolio of questions here to turn to the panel. And one of the questions was, what about protecting human rights in the private sector? Is there, and perhaps, I don't know if there's anyone on the panel who's thought about this and want to have any observations about that. Joan?
This is an answer to several of the questions, I think. And it comes from a historian who doesn't think that terms like privacy or secularism or even rights have absolute meaning. And it goes back to the question asked way in the back about the political contests about theoretical terms. It seems to me that privacy in some Supreme Court decisions has become a right. How it gets articulated, under what conditions, why it's invoked, and to protect what, has an interesting and long history. And so I would say that privacy has indeed become one of the rights that we look to be protected demanding certain kinds of individual protections from government intervention. same thing for secularism. There is no, your maximalist, minimalist definition is one way of contrasting what are different kinds of histories in different kinds of countries. The American Establishment Clause, which protects religion in a sense from the state, the French laïcité, which protects the state and its citizens from the claims of religion or religious groups. So I think that many of these questions about what these things mean can only be answered historically. And then the historical answer actually looks at the political contests and arguments that have been made about these terms and those which have prevailed and those which haven't. Jonathan's talk yesterday told us that the radical enlightenment didn't prevail in many areas of the creation of the French state or the writing of the first French constitution. They were a minority voice rather than a majority voice. It seems to me that's how we get to understand what political work these philosophical concepts can do, have done, and what spaces there are to use them for the kinds of claims that we want to make.
Thank you. Any other comments, members of the panel? What about, this talk was a very interesting observation here on the impact of European initiatives in the area of human rights and its possible threatening by the rise of, as described, the security state. And I'm wondering if any panel members wanted to respond to that question. It seemed to me to be a very interesting development.
I think it's highly relevant, and I think it's the right model, and I think it was an amazing achievement. And this, let me use an analogy. In the Human Rights Declaration, there is an article against slavery. In the American Constitution, the Amendment 13 makes this right a constitutional right. There is no question that in the United States, having a constitutional right has much more bite and much more force than just being shielded by the Human Rights Declaration against slavery. So the minute you have a mechanism installed to defend those rights, call them civil rights or constitutional rights, that's all for the better. The question, and that's what I tried to raise, is that in many countries that signed and are advocate of human rights, the human rights treaties are almost redundant because by law they wouldn't have done those things. And the countries, some of them were bullied to sign those agreements without really believing in them. And the main problem is addressing those countries. Now, by those countries, I mentioned failed state and I mentioned rotten state, but rotten states can outsource the nasty stuff to other countries to do the dirty work, as with a rendition. So then you are responsible, you are rotten through and through. There are lots of nasty stuff that was sent to what I call rotten state to do the nasty job. So first of all, obviously the picture here is a complicated one, but you are absolutely right that the European model is a very, very good one. I wish it would have been imitated in other regions of the world.
Didier, do you have a comment you want to make?
Yeah, maybe on a couple of points. On these two questions about the security state, and I think there is actually a competition of paradigms of security, humanitarianism, etc. But there's also, and that's the question about the blurring of lines, there's also combinations of the two. Many military interventions are, at least rhetorically, and sometimes more than that, justified on humanitarian grounds. And on the other side, humanitarian organizations very often intervene in military contexts. And this blurring of lines is much more complex than what the humanitarian non-governmental organizations would like it to be. That is, they are much more linked, related to the same kinds of logics which in the book you mentioned we call states of emergency, as the military. That is, the sense of emergency, the moment they come, the sort of separation they do with the local population, the moment they leave, even the goals they assert they are pursuing, the separation between the two is much less clear than it is supposed. So the security state on which you're right to insist is also is not incompatible with a humanitarian state as we see it in situations of emergency. Second remark briefly on Menahem's point about NGOs. It's true that as Avishai was suggesting, we have what we could call a non-governmental government today as a global reality. But I think we have to be maybe as critical, not in the sense of criticizing, but having critical thinking. If we say that the states may be driven by or acting with hypocrisy, we have to think that non-governmental organizations, at least in my experience, have also their part of naivety in the way they apprehend the world, which doesn't mean in any case that non-governmental organizations are only naive or that states are only hypocritical. But I think we have to avoid to have a good side, which would be the NGOs, and a bad side, which would be the states, which is typically the rhetoric of many of these NGOs. And here, the distinction, very interesting distinction that you make between internal and external NGOs, I think it brings us to the question of sovereignty. I think when the internal or non-governmental organization discard or criticize the view of the external NGOs, it's at least in part for reasons of sovereignty. This is our obligation to our people, and be careful with what you're telling us to do. So it's very interesting because it's sovereignty where we think in terms of human rights also. But I would also emphasize the fact that this kind of competition and rivalry, as you mentioned, but there's also a global circulation that it goes much beyond the opposition. In the case of trauma in Palestine, for example, it's not so much the French or international NGOs that brought the concept of trauma as an argument to present publicly the cause of the Palestinians, but it came initially from a Palestinian organization with a psychiatrist who had done his study in Britain, and so it came locally but through different ways. So there's a global circulation of concept and tools, and there's also global networks, and to finish on that, in South Africa, for example, the local organization, Treatment Action Campaign, was working very closely with Doctors Without Borders in their raising the question of drug access, for example.
Thank you. There was also a question, I believe the question was, and I phrased it improperly, please let me know, the question of, I think it was phrased as sacrifice in democracy, that who is it that has a duty to intervene? Is it just governments? Are there others who have duties? That was a question raised, and I'm wondering if the panel had any responses to that.
May I? There are two senses of intervening. One is military intervening, really, in the territory, direct intervention, as in Somalia, as in, or by striking from the air, as in Yugoslavia. And then there is boycott and other means, including naming and shaming, namely pressure from the outside, making the practice in a particular place unpleasant for the people to, when they go abroad, for example, being shamed by pressure. So we have a whole range of interference. I was taken as advocating interference as a good thing in itself, that it never crossed my mind. All I'm saying is that, again, it all should be taken on a retail basis, case by case, what you can do and what you cannot do. And I don't have a universal recipe of what should be done in the abstract. What should be done in the abstract, of course, is defending human rights. But how to defend them? What is the best effective? Can you be effective? Which are the, lots of them I don't have a cogent answer. And sometimes I can say maybe something intelligent, knowing some facts about the case. But talking in the abstract is really what I think bogged down the whole project of human rights. Now, I wasn't triumphalist about human rights. I was triumphalist about the talk about human rights. That's not the same thing. The record of human rights is something else. And this may, I don't know, I mean, on average, maybe it's better or not. But the talk of human rights is gaining force, and I think it's a good thing. That's unequivocally a good thing.
Good idea. Yes, Jonathan?
Just to comment on this question of non-government organizations. I think it's worth reminding oneself that the original historical context in which human rights arise, there was no question of the state being the main vehicle, because the state was totally opposed to the whole idea. As Brissot, for instance, and many of the people I were talking about yesterday, if you go back to the 1770s and 80s, how are human rights going to become a political force, which is a real question for them? There's only one way: by publishing books, by instigating discussion, by promoting the concept in the public. Among the public, there was no idea whatsoever of human rights in, say, 1770, so it had to be introduced, and there's only one way of doing that. So surely there are many situations where today and in the recent past where the state can't be the primary vehicle for promoting the cause of human rights. As Amnesty International emphasized all along, it has to come from below, and has come from below in very effective ways since the 1980s in all sorts of contexts. The trouble is that there are even more contexts where it doesn't work, and it often doesn't work because the awareness or consciousness of the idea is not very strongly established or rooted. So whether it's possible to promote an awareness of human rights more effectively than has been done or not is a very real question. But if it can be done more effectively, then surely it's the same strategy again. It's simply a question of trying to propagate awareness by the means of expression and the freedoms that are available to do that.
Thank you. Any final comments from any members of the panel? Well, in that case, let me just thank you all for being here this morning. Thank the panelists for their... And one ultimately important announcement, namely lunch is available 12:30 in the dining hall. Thank you all. You're all welcome. Thank you very much, John.